Next up on This Week in Law, Matt Curtis, Bob Cattanach, and Josh Gilliland join me. I'm Denise Howell. We're going to look at the rollback of the FCC's ISP privacy rules. We'll look, too, at encryption and the state of backdoors and mandated backdoors in the wake of recent terrorism in London and comments by FBI Director Comey. We'll have some fun, too. We'll look at how to use social media wisely and whether Han Solo was justified in shooting Greedo first, which, of course, he did. All this and much more next on This Week in Law.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for This Week in Law is provided by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com.
This is TWiL, This Week in Law with Denise Howell, Mike Keyes, and Matt Curtis. Episode 381, recorded March 31st, 2017. We want to believe. This episode of This Week in Law is brought to you by Blue Apron, the number one fresh ingredient and recipe delivery service in the country. See what's on the menu this week and get three meals free with your first purchase and free shipping by going to blueapron.com/twill. Hi, folks. Denise Howell here, and you're joining us for This Week in Law. We've got such an interesting show for you this week because, as I was telling everyone on the panel before we fired up here, seldom or never have I seen in our rundown such a great mix of serious topics and very light-hearted ones as well. So we're going to cover it all today, and we've got a great panel of folks to do that with. I'd like to introduce you to Matt Curtis. Matt is our new slash incoming intern here at This Week in Law. He's a law student at Notre Dame School of Law and the host of A Pint of Law, a budding legal podcast that you should also check out. Hi, Matt. Great to see you.
Hi. Great to see you guys. And thank you so much for having me on. I've been a longtime listener, so it's really neat to be part of the process now.
Yeah, it is neat to have you on, a longtime listener, first-time caller, first-time co-host with me. Emery is grinding away, studying for the bar exam, and Mike is grinding away, devoting himself to the Final Four, I believe, at this point in his particular life. But he should be back next week. But in lieu of Mike Keyes, Mike very, very kindly threw one of his partners under the bus. Bob Cattanach is joining us today on the show, who's a partner at Dorsey & Whitney, along with Mike Keyes. Great to see you, Bob.
Nice to be here. Thanks.
Bob is in their Minneapolis office. Bob, you're the head of the cybersecurity, privacy, and social media practice, among other things, at your firm, correct?
That's right, yes.
And also a former Justice Department lawyer, a Naval Academy graduate, and Wisconsin law grad. So great to have you back on, or have you on the show for the first time, Bob. Great to have you.
Nice to be here. Thanks.
Also joining us for the first time is Josh Gilliland. Hello, Josh.
Hello. Pleasure to be here.
I should have asked you before we started, did I say your non-French and actually Scottish name correctly?
You did. Thank you. Just pronounce everything and we're good to go. Don't add a U. Don't add an I at the end. You're good.
Perfect. Perfect. Josh is the co-author of one of our very favorite blogs, The Legal Geeks. We've had some of your co-authors and contributors on the show before. He's also the author of the Bowtie Law blog, a Comic-Con panelist, once in future, I assume, and also an e-discovery expert. So great to meet you, Josh.
Thank you. It's been a lot of fun. Followed you on Twitter for years, so it's great to be here. And you know, I'll try to do Jessica proud after her performance back in November.
You will, I'm sure. We are starting out with some of the more serious topics in our rundown today. Something that's, I'm sure, much on many, many people's minds this week. SJ Res 34, which you might more commonly know as the rolling back of the privacy rules that were enacted by the FCC last fall. All right, Right. So there is a whole lot of information, a whole lot of consternation out there about the fact that there was a joint resolution of the House and Senate that will now go to the president's desk for signature that undoes some privacy rules that were imposed upon ISPs. They were announced last fall. They were formally published and so became effective, but the period after which they would become effective started last December. So they are not actually in effect, and they never have been in effect, but they would have gone into effect later this year. And they would have imposed some rules on ISPs in how they handle customer data and what they can do with customer data. And if they're going to do things like use customer data for advertising purposes for use by third parties, they would have had to expressly have customers opt into that kind of regime. Those rules are not going to go into effect now. And in fact, we can go ahead and show you, because in all of the coverage and furor around all this, what you may not have seen is the actual joint resolution itself. And we have a copy of that pulled up for you to look at, if Victor can throw it up there. As I said, SJ Res 34. And all it says, scroll down a bit, Victor. You can see you actually have a copy that shows you that looks like parchment that they're trying to depict that actual laws get made on here, and some very fancy Gothic writing. This tiny little thing that you're looking at is what has launched 1,000 articles this week, and what we're going to talk about here on the show. And all it says is that Congress disapproves the rule submitted by the FCC relating to protecting the privacy of customers of broadband and other telecommunications services, and such rules shall have no force or effect. So it's not going to have force or effect. What I think a lot of people might not have realized is it never did have force or effect. This never went into effectiveness, because there was a time frame after its publication during which ISPs could scramble and get ready and begin to apply it. So one thing I think for folks to realize from the get-go is, although this rule would have been a very great step ahead for consumers and given them privacy protections that they didn't have before it was enacted, it's not so. These protections are not being wrenched away from you at this point. They were never in effect. So while it was something that a lot of people were very excited about, very consumer friendly in nature, you're not going to see a huge change in the way things have been going thus far, because really nothing is altering, although the ISPs and what they will be able to do is different than had the rule gone into effect. So that's my preamble here and our introduction to what happened this week. I'm going to open it up to the panel now and just sort of get everybody's temperature about your take on the joint resolution to do away with the rule and what you think happens next. Let's start with Bob.
Yeah, I think notwithstanding all of the hullabaloo, this was more symbolic than significant as a practical matter. Give me just 1 minute. The ability to take consumer information, aggregate it, sell it by ISPs, was a theoretical concept, but in truth, that market is dominated by, right now, Google and Facebook. And it's not at all clear to me that from a business proposition model that would have driven it any place. I think what was symbolic is that it was a rollback. It was a step toward greater consumer protection of their privacy. It got rolled back, which says the big gorillas, Facebook and Google, they're safe for now, for sure. I mean, one of two things could have happened. They could have raised the bar for Facebook and Google after this happened to create a level playing field, or they could have lowered it for the ISPs. They lowered it. Without getting off topic, I think a much bigger issue from a consumer, real meaningful impact perspective is going to be what happens to the regulation of broadband, which is also clearly in the conversation. But as far as this one goes, I honestly don't think it's that big of a deal as a practical matter.
Before we move on to the rest of the panel, let me just follow up on one thing you said there. The premise of your remark was that, I think, if I'm understanding you right, that Facebook and Google already have the ability and are buying and selling people's information, and that ISPs now will just be in the same boat. But don't ISPs know a lot more about consumers than any one search engine, email provider, social network?
My sense is actually not so much. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is tens of billions of dollars of revenue for Facebook and Google. I don't think that revenue stream magnitude was ever contemplated by the ISPs. Not that I have seen any business models. I mean, clearly they have a lot of information. There's a whole side issue about as encryption is increasingly used, what the ISPs can even see. So end of the day, let me put it this way. I don't think there's any consumer that's going to change their behaviors or as a result of what happened on the rollback.
Okay, well, we'll get into that more and probe a little deeper there as we pursue this discussion. But right now, Matt, tell me what your take on this is.
So I looked at this kind of through a structural analysis. I think that a lot of what the Republicans were saying is that it should have been done through the FTC and not the FCC. And to make that argument, they made the one analysis that we should be treated the same as Facebook and Google. And that was kind of, at least for, you know, not to the general public, but to the House, that's kind of what they based their analysis on. And then their second argument is that they should be regulated through the FTC. My understanding of what the FTC is in charge of regulating is things that have monopolies and antitrust. And I think on the ground, these providers do have a level of monopoly or anti-competitive in that the option to leave is hard. Now, the option to leave Google is not a good one for me, and I'm not going to do that. But realistically, I could. I think they have inconsistent arguments for how they got to that the FCC should not be regulating this. On that basis, I don't think I'm in favor of it. I agree, though, that this is largely not change anything on the ground over time. I do think it does give people who want their privacy the option to essentially pay for it. And I think the cost-benefit analysis falls on having this rule in place.
You raise a really interesting point there, because that's something I wanted to make sure and bring up during the show as we have this discussion. And one of the complaints that people had about the FCC rules that did come out last winter was that pay for privacy was still on the table. That was not something that was specifically ruled out and made inappropriate or illegal or unavailable to ISPs. So it was on the table under the rules that would have gone into effect. It's still on the table. It's not necessarily the greatest result for consumers that, you know, you could decide that you could either get the cheap broadband and sacrifice a lot or pay through the nose and feel like you're more protected. But that sort of scenario never went away and still exists. So I'm glad you brought that up, Matt. Josh, what do you think?
This is a really fun way for me to have flashbacks to administrative law back in law school. And it's a good civics lesson for the American public on how administrative rulemaking works and congressional oversight and, you know, the congressional rollback measures. So on an academic level, there's that. On the other level, I look at this and go, all right, how much was this a policy discussion as opposed to just, you know, a Republican administration rejecting what a Democratic administration did and in the closing months of one term? So there's that. Things that I think about with this is the way people react, because we have a news cycle where people react to the headlines. So there's not necessarily a lot of analysis. It's people freaking out over, like, oh, God, privacy's gone. It's like, no, that's not what this says. And there's lots of articles that explain the different issues with it. And the way that this tends to expand into different areas with that we'll get into, whether it's the FBI wanting backdoors into things or whether it's content searches being sold. I'm like, those are all legitimate things to talk about. But, you know, the issue is, don't freak out. Let's break it down and take it one step at a time.
Yeah, I think that's the right approach. And I'm glad you brought up going back to administrative law and how things work, because that's something that we should delve into a little more deeply here so that people understand what happened. Various agencies like the FCC have the ability to promulgate rules within the purview of their authority. And there's been a lot of debate about whether the FCC under Chairman Wheeler exceeded its authority or not. That question really doesn't come up or get resolved by the resolution that we showed you. But the congressional review process does have this kicker that after rolling back this rule and deciding this is one that we're going to review and not approve, as we showed you, what also is the fallout of that is that the agency then is prohibited from reissuing the rule in substantially the same form or issuing a new rule that is substantially the same, unless the reissued or new rule is specifically authorized by law and acted after the date of the joint resolution disapproving the original rule. So if you have seen people writing that it literally would take an act of Congress to put the rolled back privacy rule back in place, that's what they mean, because once Congress has acted in this way, there are some substantial hurdles to go through to reinstate what they have rolled back. So that's not necessarily great news for consumers and privacy protection. One thing that I put in the rundown, and everything we're looking at for the show today, as with all our shows, is available for all of you to take a look at after the show as well. If you go to tagpacker.com/user/thisweekinlaw, you'll find all the links that we have looked at in getting ready for the show. And one of the pieces that I have in there is by Ryan Radia, who we've had on the show before, he is with the Competitive Enterprise Institute. And what they have done, the title of the article is Six Reasons FCC Rules Aren't Needed to Protect Privacy. I think you could take issue with whether they were needed or not. But he has run down several things that should make you feel better if you feel badly about what has gone on here. And at least, you know, make you... perhaps give you a roadmap to where advocacy groups like the EFF will take things in coming days. He mentions that federal and state wiretapping laws are still in place, and it's generally illegal to intentionally intercept or divulge the contents of electronic communications, including internet traffic, without the consent of the party to the communications. There's more detail about those Wiretapping Act laws there that you can check out. The state attorneys general are still in place and the state laws that they get to enforce are still in place. And those many states have laws. In fact, Ryan writes, every state has a law on the books making it illegal for companies to engage in deceptive practices. And so in the case that there is an ISP deceiving a consumer about what they're doing with their data, that would be prosecutable. And of course, all of these ISPs have privacy policies in place. And in response to this, as we were getting ready for the show this week, I didn't exactly have a, you know, we do these tips and resources of the week at the end of the show. I didn't have a resource lined up. And so what I decided to do and what we'll do in coming weeks is our resources of the week are going to start to be ISP privacy policies. And we're going to start this week with AT&T. We'll do that at the end of the show. And we'll give you some insight into what your ISP's privacy policy may say about its ability to use your data. And again, as Ryan points out here, it is actionable for those ISPs to violate their privacy policies. So you should know what yours provides. And if you don't like it, you should do something about it, either by choosing a different ISP if that's available to you. That has a better policy, because you know we're left with having the market police this at this point, at least partially. And if that doesn't work for you, then just get loud about it. You know, definitely keep letting your representatives know that you don't like how this is working. Certainly let the ISP know that, you know, in particular, you're not wild about or don't understand one of their practices. So we're going to start highlighting those. Other things that come into play here that we've already touched upon are encryption, the use of HTTPS, VPNs, the availability of them. And we're going to, I think that now would be a good time to look into whether those are actually things that people can put some confidence in. We have at least two or three stories in our rundown for this week headlined with things like encryption won't stop your internet provider from spying on you. Also that VPNs, let's see, I'm losing track in my rundown, but the VPNs are good, but not a magic bullet, as The Verge puts it, and that VPNs won't save you from Congress's actions here. And what those articles pretty much point out is that, you know, for example, if you're going to use a VPN to shield your actions from your ISP, of course, you need to trust your VPN provider then, not to track and sell your data itself. And, you know, they may not have the greatest privacy policies in place or the greatest security measures in place. And also, you might find that VPN'd internet use is not the free and easy and full access use that you're used to, because some companies, Netflix being a good example, might block you if you're using a VPN. So not a perfect solution, but certainly something to look into. And also there's a really interesting piece in The Atlantic on the encryption front. That yes, it's harder and harder to view web traffic because of various encryption measures in place, but it basically discusses the cat and mouse around that and concludes that as online encryption spreads further and further across the internet, there will be monetary incentives to dig up as much information on users as possible to offset the loss of access to more detailed unencrypted data. And it goes through some examples of how, even though information is encrypted, it's not impossible to figure out what's going on and who's engaged in the activity. So again, not perfect solutions here, but as Congress has kicked this somewhat back to the marketplace, you should know what your options are. Bob, what do you think about encryption and VPNs being some sort of consolation prize for consumers here?
Yeah, I think you said it well, and they are not perfect. but they are an alternative. Obviously, there's also the standard opt-out provision, which is tedious but available. One thing that we haven't talked about that I want to go to in one second, but to wrap on this, I think the technology will get better. I think we're going to see more seamless alternatives. I think some of the current encryption can slow things down, but that's a market issue. It's not a technology issue. They just have to kind of hone what they do. If I may, the one thing we haven't mentioned that is going to have, I believe, a huge effect is state laws. You are already seeing many state legislatures considering the exact kind of protections that were provided by the FCC. Just coincidentally, I think the Minnesota Senate 2 days ago passed it. And I don't know that the House will, but I don't know that they won't. I think what you tend to see in this space is a lot of Me Too provisions by state legislators with a more sort of, if you will, forward-thinking ones. California, Connecticut, Illinois, Minnesota, there's a bunch. They're going to go there pretty quickly, I believe. And then there'll be other potential legal consequences with that. But I would say this, bottom line, the ISP consumer privacy issue is anything but dead.
Mm-hmm. And do you think that as states start enacting their own responses to this, or many states probably already have things in place that are at least part of the way down the road of what the FCC rules would have been. Does that mean that the ISPs, don't most ISPs do business in most states, at least the big ones do? And would that mean that they would have, they certainly wouldn't want to have different policies in one state than they would in another? That seems like it would be pretty complicated. So if one state has consumer-friendly policies, does that assist other states?
Yeah, I think it does. I believe that it's very difficult to have a compliance with a patchwork quilt series of regulations. There is some good news that at least the very preliminary legislative measures I've seen are very similar. So it's not like you'd have to do something in one state and then very, very different in another. I think that it's a fairly consistent approach. But the point I think that you make is a good one, which is be careful what you wish for. You had a single uniform federal standard that's now gone, and filling that vacuum are going to be state legislators and potentially state regulatory officials.
Right. So ironically, if the goal here was to undo regulation and make things less complicated and more business friendly for ISPs, what you're saying, Bob, is it may wind up backfiring on them.
Yeah, I very well could, and I would not bet against that. I would almost, you can guarantee that many states and significant in terms of commercial important states will pick up this banner, and they're going to pass these laws, and the ISPs are going to be right back where they started. And with a little bit of luck, they won't be too terribly different a series of compliance obligations, but it didn't take but a couple of days before you saw state legislative initiatives. So that I just keep your eye on that space.
If I can add, we've already seen this when it comes to data breach and data privacy laws across the United States, with states such as California, New York, and ironically Texas have some of the strictest ones. And what you then get is, in order to comply with data breach laws across the country, companies pick the most strict because, are you going to say, we're not going to do business in New York? We're not going to do business in California? And the default is the most strict state in order to, for compliance. And in theory, that should bootstrap you into all the lesser ones. So, there will be a market solution to this. It won't be as clean, but we've already seen it play out with data breach cases.
Can I add something?
Sure.
So I think that one of the differences, though, is that when those things happened in the last 8 years, we've lived under the Obama administration, who has been pro-privacy. And so they didn't try to legislate this on a commerce power issue. I'm not exactly clear if they're going to win on that. But since the since the Congress just spoke on this, I'm not sure if this won't come out to a court decision on whether they've spoken on the Congress issue and therefore states can't legislate this unless it's only in state. I know there's a lot of legislation in regards to online gambling right now, and that's kind of where the line has come out with states running those.
What do you think, Bob? Or is Congress going to be able to argue that they've preempted states from doing what you suggest?
Not yet, but I think it's a very good point to begin with. Let's have this discussion after we figure out what Chairman Pai is going to be doing with the classification of broadband. I think right now it would be difficult to argue preemption, but I don't think we're in a static environment. So I think the preemption possibility is always going to be out there. And it's a separate discussion maybe, but for right now, I don't think it's going to dissuade many states. The fear of being preempted in a court case is not going to slow many of these states down, the aggressive ones.
Right. This sort of gets us back to, we were talking about the FTC rules, Federal Trade Commission rules, that govern privacy, and how this all ties in with net neutrality, because as of the FCC's open internet rules now in effect, still in effect, how do I put this? Broadband has been classified as something that the FTC no longer has jurisdiction over. So although people have been saying, oh, the FTC guidelines still apply, there are many responses to that. Number one being, no, technically not under the way broadband has been classified by the FCC, and that still persists. And number two, the FTC rules, even if they did apply, and Chairman Pai has said that the FCC and the FTC will, quote unquote, work together to reinstate some form of privacy protections for broadband customers. So even if the FTC rules don't squarely apply, it seems like they're going to say that's okay. We're gonna make sure that we have some sort of comprehensive privacy structure in place that is uniform. I think getting to your point, Bob, about having chaotic state by state legislation on this. But the FTC rules, the complaint about them is that they are not as, they're less strict than the ones the FCC promulgated. They do allow for opt-out systems, and we'll talk about that more when we look closer at AT&T's privacy policy later on in the show. But they don't go as far as the rules that are not going to be enacted went. What do we do with this? There's much to unpack here and discuss, and I think we can continue to do so, but in a more lighthearted vein for this discussion, does anybody on our panel think that the creator of Cards Against Humanity is going to be able to buy and publish anybody's internet history, including members of Congress? What do you think, Bob?
I'll pass on that one. I think you could sell tickets to it, though.
Absolutely. Josh?
While entertaining, I don't think it would happen. Even though it would be fun to do a FOIA request for search history for members of Congress, I don't know if that's ever been done before, but maybe we could find some stuff out. That'd be fun.
And Matt, do you take this seriously at all as a thing that could happen?
After I saw him dig a hole and watched the whole world watch it, I'm not going to bet against him.
All right. Well, the ISPs might bet against him. One of the things I wanted to call out and mention on the show is in January of this year, the ISPs petitioned the FCC itself to stay the privacy rules that would have gone into place. They got their relief not from the FCC, but from Congress and the Senate, and ultimately the president, who is, I believe, expected to sign this. I don't think we can expect last minute reprieves from the White House on this one. Not according to the statements they've put out in any event. But one of the things that the ISPs argued in urging the FCC itself to stay enforcement of the privacy rules is that they already have your back. That ISP, here's what their brief said, a portion of what their brief said. Further, ISPs have released a voluntary set of privacy and data security principles that are consistent with the FTC's longstanding framework and have committed to continue adhering to these obligations, regardless of whether the commission's broadband privacy rules are stayed, thereby further minimizing the risk of harm to other parties. So, aside from the fact that they all do have their own privacy policies that can say various things, they had committed to a voluntary set of principles that they think went far enough. Do you think, Bob, that they will continue, given what they told the FCC back in January, that they'll continue to voluntarily adhere to those principles that they mentioned?
Yeah, I do. I think those principles are a little general in nature. But what the subject you're now raising, I think, is the fundamental one that is has proven difficult to deal with, and that's this. This is a feel-good policy. In some ways, the FCC's policy was a feel-good policy. Mm-hmm. People want to believe that they can, in fact, protect their privacy when, as a practical matter, it's darn nigh impossible to do so if you spend any time Google or Facebook or anything else. So you have this sort of cognitive dissonance among most people, including myself, that, well, okay, I'll just, there's certain things I will do and there's certain things I won't do, but, they say they're watching out for my privacy, so I must be okay. Well, privacy is, a vanishing concept in any event. And I hate to be a curmudgeon about this, but I do think some of the hue and cry about, oh, we're going to lose our privacy, we lost our privacy a long time ago.
Yep. And we're going to get to what FBI Director James Comey had to say on that front as well once we wrap up, this discussion about the FCC. But I feel you there. We want to believe, but perhaps what we're believing in is not well grounded in fact. What do you think about that, Josh?
People need to think about their online experiences right now. You log into Facebook or you visit different websites, you're going to get targeted ads based upon your internet search history and what you look for, what you look at. And you could argue that's like, hey, and violating my privacy. And it's like, no, it's not. Those were the terms of service for using a free service and how those businesses make money. Now, I don't believe privacy is a vanishing concept. I'm quite fond of the Fourth Amendment, and it depends what kind of privacy we're talking about, be it content versus search history versus terms of service agreements. There's a lot of factors in play on what you deem to be private. But attorneys have a professional responsibility in working with clients thinking about these privacy issues. For example, you shouldn't have a client using Gmail because Google scans that content and targets ads to the client based upon their content. So it's like, pick a different domain, pick a different email address, or have a different way of communicating, like the way health providers do, where most of them require you to log in and use their service to communicate with your doctor. So there are ways that you got to think about this because, yes, a lot of your search and online persona impacts the ads that you see and what's targeted to you in order for people to make money. That's just commerce. But if you do have true privacy issues, such as HIPAA compliance or attorney-client communications, in California, we have a six-factor test to ensure that confidential information staying confidential if we're using Wi-Fi or email. So think about those things. And it's not a simple answer.
Mm-hmm. No, it's not at all. Bob, I was wondering if you got a chance. We had a lot of links related to this particular topic, but one of them was from the EFF. And it's titled, Five Ways Cybersecurity Will Suffer. Listen to EFF getting all clickbaity. Five ways cybersecurity will suffer if Congress repeals the FCC privacy rules. And they mention a number of reasons why this is not just bad for people's privacy, but potentially bad for potentially exposing them to malware and hacks. Did you have a chance to take a look at this, and do you agree?
I have not taken a look at it, and I'm sorry about that.
That's okay. Let me run down some of the things for you right now and see, just get your take. What the first risk they raise is snooping on traffic and creating new targets for hackers. I think what the EFF is getting to here and what they say is that ISPs don't have a great, some of them anyway, don't have a great security track record when it comes to keeping customer information safe. And that's one of the things that's getting rolled back with this congressional action, by the way. Aside from what they can do with your data, there was a requirement that reasonable steps be taken to ensure the security of your data. That is going away as well. So I think the EFF's point here is simply, if ISPs are seen as these treasure troves of user data, which I think you'd have to say they've always been that before or after this action, that makes them, I guess, honeypots for people to come in and try and get that data. What they say is this would just be the fallout from passive data collection, where your internet provider simply spies on your data as it goes by. An even scarier risk is that internet providers want to be able to do much more than that. So I think what conclusion they want us to draw there is, you know, if they're actively keeping track of data, that's more that could leak out and be hacked. So that's their point one. Point two has to do with encryption. Let's see, means that many of the systems designed to encrypt and then re-encrypt data actually end up weakening the security of encryption, which exposes users to increased risk of cyber attack. Simply put, if internet providers think they can profit from looking at your encrypted data, this goes to the Atlantic point that we were raising, whether they're piercing through encryption or trying to piece together things that they can tell about encrypted data, and start deploying these systems widely, we'll no longer be able to trust the security of our web browsing. So they're worried about encryption and the cat and mouse around it that might ensue. Inserting ads into your browsing, that where the ads themselves are opening holes in your browser security. And then I love this one, zombie super cookies. These are inserting a unique ID number into every unencrypted connection your browser makes with a website, then a website that wants to know more about you. So they can decide, they can pay your internet provider a little money to tell them what ID number they want to know about, and your internet provider will share the desired info associated with that ID number. So the thing, and this is not the first outlet that I've seen raise this super cookie issue, basically undetectable, untrackable cookies operating in the background that you can't control is the risk. And then the final risk they raise is spyware opening the door to malware. I guess is pretty straightforward. If they're selling data to others, they can't and or maybe won't control what others do with that information, and spyware could result in spyware is not always or really seldom ever beneficial to the person being spied upon, and can actually be actively dangerous and harmful. So, Bob, anything you want to chime in on with the EFF's concerns?
So there's a legitimate concerns, but we have to distinguish between a technological problem or weakness and a policy problem. Now, and not to overgeneralize too much, but the tenor of those points is that if you roll back the policy a little bit, then you're going to create an opportunity to exploit technical vulnerabilities. Well, I mean, that's probably true to some extent. I'm not sure that anyone can quantify how much worse it is now versus what it would be if you had these protections in place. But I'm not convinced that from the technological vulnerability perspective, you couldn't providers can improve their game once they know where the threat vectors are. So I think well intentioned for sure. I'm not sure it's borne out by any current practice or data. So it's certainly a possibility, maybe even a probability to some degree. But I think that's a little bit of an overreach on this is all the bad things that are going to happen if you roll that back. I'm not convinced of that. Last thing I'll say is, remember that I don't think these ISPs are gonna take back their own privacy policy commitments. They're voluntary, but the FTC, I think, would have enforcement authority over deceptive trade practices. So if any carrier says, well, this is what we're doing to protect your data, they fail to do it, I think they may have some potential FTC liability.
Right. And there's something the EFF doesn't raise here. It's sort of off topic for the cybersecurity threats that it was running down. But to that point, just to mention again, the point that Ryan Radia raises, that ISPs deceiving consumers, the EFF raises Carrier IQ as an example of spyware that was installed on phones that ISPs claimed was only to improve wireless network service and performance. Well, of course, if that's not accurate, whatever ISP rolls out something like that is going to be, you know, squarely in the EFF's and others' crosshairs, and legal recourse will ensue. But the other specter that's out there is that the ISPs see this action by Congress as an invitation to start altering their privacy policies and the standards that they've voluntarily decided to comply with. Does anybody on the panel think, certainly it's something to keep an eye on, but does anybody think that we're going to see a huge uptick in ISPs amending their privacy policies and giving themselves more of a data grab? What do you think, Matt?
I think that they're looking at the numbers too, and they see the advertising revenue that Google and Facebook are looking at. The idea that they're not looking at that money and wanting a piece of it, I think is crazy. So I think that to the extent that people aren't upset and there isn't a large pushback for it, I think they'll take what they can get. And that's why in this whole discussion, I would fall on the side of an opt-out policy, similar, you know, pretty much what the FCC had. Bargained for these rights, but not they didn't come automatically.
Opt-out or opt-in? Because the FCC, before they could, ISPs could sell your data, the FCC wanted you to expressly opt into that.
Yeah, I think either would be better than not, you know, pretty much not having an option. I think you opt out would be the best.
Opt out would be the best. Well, that may be what we're left with. And, you know, I mean, it's going to vary.
I'm sorry. I meant opt in. I was thinking about the wrong way.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Okay. That's why I followed up. Josh, what do you think?
We're trying to predict the future, and we're speculating extremely on what could happen. ISPs, yeah, they want to make money. They also don't want to lose customers because of security risks, or whether it's real or imagined. And this is something we have to monitor. That's all we have to do right now.
Right.
Or if you're really aggressive and have a tech background, start making security apps, and people can buy, put on their phones to protect them. So, or if you really want to get aggressive, maybe there's a place for plaintiff and defense attorneys to build practice areas for perceived data breaches, and whether you want to go prosecute them or defend companies for them.
I'm so glad you raised the security app issue. That's certainly something that we've seen play out in Do Not Track and various ad blockers and things that have tried to prevent companies like Google and Facebook from being able to gather enormous dossiers about you. The AFF's Privacy Badger extension for Chrome comes to mind. I'm not quite sure what people will be able to develop to make a user-friendly, consumer-friendly ISP shield. I mean, maybe that's just a VPN, and those exist. But we might see, as you point out, Josh, a whole market of apps spring up in response to this. Bob, any final thoughts?
The only other thing I'd say, I do agree with Josh. I think that the market could provide us some alternatives there that hasn't thus far, because I think the demand side has been a little soft, but I think this dialogue increases the visibility of this issue. Mm-hmm. But I advise companies that work in this space, and I can share with you that the mentality or the core culture of major companies right now is they do not want to be the next Yahoo. The appetite for risk, whether it's unintended intrusion by outside hackers or playing a little fast and loose with gathering data and then selling it, I mean, I think that's kryptonite right now. And mm-hmm. Yes, there's revenue out there, and I'm not going to suggest people aren't going to look hard at revenue, but boy, I think the reputable companies are going to be very, very careful not to step over the line, because the reputational damage to the brand, it could be huge if they mess this up.
Right. And the other thing I think we need in response to this, I've been putting a couple of calls out on social media and haven't had anybody say, oh, haven't you seen this? This exists already. So if it does exist, please let me know, but I haven't found it yet. Certainly it would be great to have a site or a clearinghouse or some sort of definitive information source on, you know, which ISPs have the best policies, which ones are doing exactly what Bob pointed out, you know, being very conservative and consumer respectful of data, because it's in their interest to be that way in many ways. And which ones have decided to go all wild, wild west with your data and decide to explore new revenue streams. So if there's anyone listening who wants to develop such a tool, I think that we could use one and certainly keep your eyes out for such things and let us know if you stumble across them. We're going to do our own little bit here by starting to look at ISP privacy policies in a little bit of detail at the end of each show. What else? We need a MCLE passphrase for this episode of This Week in Law. We could put a couple into each show in case you are a lawyer or other professional who likes to watch or listen to the show for professional credit in your field. If you'd like more information about that, head on over to our wiki at wiki.twit.tv/thisweekinlaw. I'm sorry, wiki.twit.tv, and you're going to find I'm not going to give you the URL because it's a little complicated with underscores and stuff, but you're going to find our This Week in Law page there. And we've got a nice chart that tells you, if you're a lawyer, about applying for credit in your jurisdiction. Our first phrase for this show is going to be ISPs and me. in response to the discussion we've been having, and I'm sure we'll continue to have in the coming months. But right now, let's move on to a related kind of discussion, not directly related to ISPs, though we have been discussing encryption. And Bob mentioned the notion of Director Comey and the fact that absolute privacy does not exist, seems to be his take on the matter in recent remarks. But what I wanted to revisit is something we've talked about a lot on the show in the wake of the event in London. Recently, Khalid Massoud came out that his phone had connected to messaging app WhatsApp 2 minutes before he killed four people in Westminster. So once again, various things that keep your communications encrypted are in the crosshairs, and it's not quite certain what's going to happen. But I think it's pretty safe to say that whether it's European governments or the U.S. government or elsewhere in the world, law enforcement has about had it with what they call going dark and the ability for people to communicate in an encrypted way that is hidden from both those trying to head off terror attacks or other bad events and from those trying to investigate and prosecute things that have already happened. So, Bob, what do you think the current status of the encryption backdoor, mandatory backdoor debate is right now?
Yeah, I don't see that changing. Mm-hmm. I do not see the tech companies bowing under and saying, you know, this is a terrible problem, and we understand that if we gave you a backdoor, you might be able to deal with it. So here's the keys to the backdoor. As noted earlier, we're speculating a little bit, but that is not a change that I anticipate. I think we will continue to see law enforcement legitimately concerned about this technology that allows encryption, and it makes their job extremely difficult. The problem, of course, is you can't just say, well, you can trust my law enforcement or national security people, so just give them the back door. Once you give one the back door, you're going to get it to every government in the world, and I think we could all agree that there are some that we would be very uncomfortable giving back doors to anything with. So I don't see that debate changing right now. I as horrific as these things are, and as legitimate as they are with their concerns with law enforcement, the tech companies have too much at stake, and they to change their course. I'd be curious to the other panelists, but I don't see that changing.
Go ahead, whoever was going to chime in.
Yeah, I hear the FBI arguments, and I almost expect them to say only the guilty to have to fear the police state. You know, the Fourth Amendment exists for a reason, and while I respect the All Writs Act, law enforcement should not have a back door to everything that we do. What's next? Why don't we just take the locks off doors if police want to come in and check things out, just to make sure they have the access to do so. So I look at this, and I see a very disturbing power grab. I don't like it. Despite being the stark raving conservative, this is the sort of thing that made me join the ACLU, because this is not okay. And we have to take a hard stand on the Fourth Amendment. And if there is evidence, by God, go get a search warrant. And the fact that tech companies aren't going to build a back door for you to get in, there are other ways for them to do that. And you know, technology is complicated. There are other solutions at play, but that's not the solution.
So one interesting thing that happened in the last week or so is Director Comey was speaking at the University of Texas and gave us some inkling into how he thought a backdoor mandate might work. Ed Felton wrote this up at the Wonderful Freedom to Tinker blog, and I encourage you to read his whole post because he really goes deep on the various problems with this assertion. But Director Comey said that one of the worlds he could imagine is a requirement that if you're going to sell a device or market a device in the United States, you must be able to comply with judicial process. You figure out how to do it. And it strikes me that he's on to something, and that may well be, you know, if Congress decides to go down this road, how they approach it, that they try and be very broad, and they simply make it mandatory for people selling devices in the U.S. that, you know, if you're served with a subpoena asking for communications made with that device, you better be able to comply with it. Bob, do you think that things might go down that road? I mean, obviously, Professor Felton here goes into great detail about how that's problematic, and I think a lot of our listeners and viewers already have a good handle on how and why it would be. But do you kind of, are you with me that Congress may decide, hey, that sounds like a good path. Let's just put it off on the device manufacturers and put the ball in their court.
It's a deceptively simple concept, isn't it? Mm-hmm. You should just figure it out.
Yeah.
I don't think that is going to happen. There are too many conservatives in Congress right now that would, I think, have concern about that, for civil libertary concern. So I don't think a legislative solution is likely to come about along those lines. I think we're going to still grapple, as we have throughout the existence of our country, the proper balance given the protections of the Fourth Amendment. Technology's changed throughout. Somehow or another, we're still standing as a nation. So there may be some other challenges, but I don't see the evisceration of the Fourth Amendment as the way to go. And as a policy matter, I don't see Congress likely to adopt Director Comey's very attractive, and from a simplistic standpoint, concept. I don't think it's going to happen.
What do you think, Matt?
I think that its ultimate effect is just to drive these sort of services into the black market. It's not like they can stop people in other countries to create these services. And so you're really just driving down your market for these companies who have been successful. So even if it could get passed, even if you could put the backdoor in there, that doesn't affect the change that he's even looking for. So mm-hmm. I think it's just a bad policy all around.
Right. It's one of those things that we were talking about, unintended and less desirable consequences. And here you might wind up with devices that were harder to access and less secure and overall just a worse situation than we're in now. Josh, anything to add?
It's tough to go further other than I don't like it.
Mm-hmm. So, alrighty then.
It's bad.
Yes, it's bad. All right. Well, sadly, we're going to have to bid a fond farewell to Bob, who has other work to do this afternoon. But I so appreciate your joining us, Bob. Great to meet you. We have so much fun week in and week out with your partner, Mike, on the show. And we'll definitely need to get you back on when he's with us.
Well, it's been my great pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Anything else you want to let us know about before you run? Anything you'd like to, any events coming up, anything that you're writing or appearing at that we should be on the eye out for?
The International Association of Privacy Professionals, not to give them a plug, but they do a nice job. They have a nice, significant event coming up in Washington in the middle of April. It's thought leaders, to be sure, from all over the globe. The last thing I would say, in this debate we're having right now, discussion is not in a vacuum. The same discussion is going on throughout the world. Keep an eye on the EU. On the one hand, they've got the most aggressive privacy policies around. On the other hand, they're right now, arguably, feeling the most pressure to deal with the threat of terrorism. So how that balance might get adjusted or not, I think will be very telling over the next 12 to 24 months.
Yep, I think that's very insightful. Great chatting with you, Bob. We're going to soldier
Thanks.
On without you, but have a wonderful day. Thanks
Thank
for joining
you.
Us.
Bye-bye.
Take care. All right. Now that we have depressed and made everyone dour and want to believe they have privacy, but they don't, we're going to move on to the balance of our stories in the show. Next topic has to do with social media. It's not going to lighten you up as much as some of what we've got in store later will, but it's starting down that road. In fact, both our social web stories are sort of cautionary tales or be careful of what's coming down the pipe. Things you that might be happening now that you're not even aware of is sort of where I'm going with the first one. And this is a post that you did, Josh, at your Bowtie Log blog Bowtie Law blog page about requesting social media and discovery. And just for you to bear in mind that a lot of our listeners, probably most of our listeners, are not lawyers, but people interested in technology, law, and policy, and hoping that we can enlighten them as to how things in their lives might work should they come into contact with the judicial system in one way or another. And I think it's probably news to people that social media in discovery is even a thing, that should you get into a legal dispute or a law enforcement related activity, many people might think that, hey, if I'm posting privately or to a, you know, small group of people non-publicly on the web, that I'm, you know, pretty comfortable and confident that that audience isn't going to be wider. You know better, don't you, Josh?
Yeah. Welcome to the world of party admissions. So there's a huge body of case law where there are requests for people's social media. Frequently, you'll see them in, say, like a personal injury case, and somebody's had physical injuries, and they can't do anything anymore. And this has happened multiple times, there somehow is a video of them riding a mechanical bull on their Facebook page after the accident. And that's rightly requested in discovery. That's happened more than once. So If you're in a lawsuit, don't be stupid. Lawyers need to talk to their clients about, hey, don't post stuff on Facebook about the case, or if you do have injuries, you just don't, you know, be dumb. Think before you post.
Don't be dumb. I think that's our perennial tip of the week here at This Week in Law, but this is just another flavor of it.
Yeah. Think before you do something. And So like going back for like the last almost a decade, when these started happening, you would get horrific requests for production from either defense counsel or plaintiff counsel wanting all social media, period. And that's just a massive fishing expedition. And of course, we're going like, no, there's the rule that it has to be relevant. You can't just go out and ask for somebody's, you know, entire Facebook profile. And because of the volume of requests that were coming in, Facebook actually created that download feature, what was I, probably around 2009, 2010, because they got tired of requests coming in for it. And the entire industry is built up with tools that can go out and collect social media. And when that happens, you should then figure out what's relevant. So you can conduct searches on what's been downloaded and look for whether it's tweets or, you know, on Tumblr, whatever, that information can go out and be captured. We see cases come out frequently because when there are requests for production, there's usually a battle, an objection of some kind, saying it's overly broad or it's seeking confidential information. And lawyers have gotten smarter over the last few years with how they request a social media profile. And this request that was in this case is actually, I thought, a good one, or at least better than the ones I've seen over the past, you know, 8-9 years. But, you know, they wanted to produce all postings related to any type of physical or athletic activities from June 6, 2014 to present on all social media websites, including but not limited to Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. I think that's a pretty good request. The court, you know, used its authority under proportionality and to help narrow it even further. And it was modified to refer or relate to the physical injuries the plaintiff alleges she sustained as a result of an accident and any treatment she received therefore, or to reflect physical capabilities that are inconsistent with the injuries that plaintiff alleged suffered as a result of the accident. Those have come into play in different cases that I've seen. Frequently, defense counsel will want to impeach a plaintiff who has a personal injury case because, again, there's either the mechanical bull riding video or, you know, pitchers playing frisbee, you know, stuff like that. And while that can actually be very helpful to defense, it could backfire badly if that information relates to a period before the accident, you know, before something bad happened to someone. Mm-hmm. Other ways that this could come in could be like in construction defect cases, because if somebody lives in a house that's moldy or has water leaks, they're going to go onto Facebook and complain about it. And when they do that, they're creating material that's relevant to the case because they're talking about the condition of the property. We've seen it in criminal cases where bad guys are stupid and they'll go out and break into something and then post pictures of it on Instagram. And that ends up at the arraignment. So There's a lot of funky, weird things that are happening where this evidence is sneaking in in a variety of different ways.
It's interesting you raise construction defect. I used to do one or two construction defect related lawsuits back at the beginning of my practice. And I remember the 10-year statute of limitations that we have in California. I assume it still applies. This was a long time ago I was doing these cases. But one thing that would come up is if you were on notice, you only had a limited amount of time to bring those claims. So if you're posting on social media that there's something wrong and then you don't take any action about it. And this could apply in any number of situations where there are statutes of limitations that keep you from suing. Someone could go to your social media and say, I'm sorry, you know, you don't get to sue about that because you knew about it way back before the period of time that you would have been allowed to sue. So something to be aware of in your social media postings. One related thing I was wondering about, Josh, from your post here, is whether parties, if everything's public, you know, I can see where someone in discovery might be trying to get at things that you hadn't posted publicly because they don't have access to that. But if everything is public, if you're the responding party, can you come back to them and say, I'm sorry, that you shouldn't make me go through all this stuff. It's all public on the web. You go find it. Who has the upper hand there?
I do think you have a good argument that it's publicly available. And if I were defense counsel going up against a plaintiff who had a public Twitter account and was publishing things left and right and public Facebook and was, you know, making public statements, we'd go grab that and grab at least the public facing information, and then probably have a, you know, there's a variety of tools that can use that, whether it's something as basic as a screenshot, which people do in like copyright cases, trademark infringement, like businesses posting something on their Facebook fan page and somebody just takes a screenshot of it, to the more advanced software that can go out and grab it, and then you have an expert who can testify about how it was done. So I would definitely do that if I were a defense. If I were plaintiff, you know, and talking to my client, I would have them work with our expert to go out and have all that data collected, because the expert then could log into their account with their username and password and grab everything, because we know we're going to have to go through that and identify what's relevant, whether it supports our claims or defenses or whether it hurts us. We need to know that. And I would do it that way for my litigation strategy.
What about the whole notion that people there, you may come across a party in a case these days who's just incredibly prolific on social media, and it becomes a signal to noise issue that you're looking for information relevant to the case And it's really, really burdensome to go through somebody's entire social media history trying to find those things. Even if everything's public, does the responding party have some duty to sort of cull through and say, okay, I'm preventing you from having to go through all my breakfast pictures and dog pictures, and I'm providing you with the bull riding pictures?
Well, it's, yeah, because the rules of relevancy still apply. So just because it's there, it has to be relevant. If it's irrelevant, why the hell are we talking about it? It's okay to let it go. The other half of this is proportionality matters. You know, if you're in federal court, and a lot of state courts have proportionality rules as well, it has to relate to the case in some way. And somebody eating breakfast cereal, probably not going to relate to the case unless it involves breakfast cereal. So that's where, you know, the tools that we have to collect do have search filters built in. So sitting down with the client going like, okay, so you got hurt. What was the date of injury? Okay, what are we alleging happened? All right, craft search terms to find things that support us and find things that hurt us. You know, it's like, okay, so you did go to Disneyland after you got hurt. Did you go on any rides? I mean, there are ways that you go, okay, going to Disneyland and you had a back injury, that doesn't look good. But if you go, yeah, I couldn't go on any of the rides anymore, and I was just there with my family, I couldn't even push the kid's stroller, but I did have a churro and it was delightful. It's like, okay, that actually doesn't look as bad, because it shows diminished capabilities from the way the person used to be able to enjoy going to an amusement park.
Right. Hey, Matt, you're still in law school, and I'm wondering if any of this kind of, you know, strategic litigation discovery and social media discussion comes up at all, or is this something you're frantically taking notes on because you may have to deal with it as a lawyer?
Mostly frantically taking notes. And I do just want to put a small pitch in for Josh's blog. It was really great to read it. I did work as a paralegal for a firm, and we had a lady who fell into all the traps that Josh is talking about, and she had been to the zoo and been to all these places when she was claiming a lot of damages. So don't be dumb. That's the recommendation.
Right. All right. And into a brief rumor mongering portion of the show here. There's not been a confirmation of this, but there's been some coverage and reporting based on leaked memos sent from Secretary of State Rex Tillerson to embassy bosses. And among the reporting on this is Phil Muncaster at Info Security Magazine, and I've seen it elsewhere as well. And these memos apparently give us some inkling of new extreme vetting measures related to social media for anyone who has traveled to a country now controlled by ISIS. And what these leaked memos seem to indicate is that mandatory social media and other checks may well be imposed on those people. We don't know anything more about that. If you're interested in this, I encourage you to read Phil Muncaster's post and other coverage of the issue. It looks like Reuters had it too. Just something related to social media to toss in. And the opportunity for me to go down the rabbit hole about some recent international travel of mine. I was really interested when I recently went to Canada, crossing from the U.S. into Canada, the really intensive questioning I got from the customs agent there. No one tried to do a mandatory social media check on me, but when I mentioned, first of all, I was traveling by myself and meeting friends in the country. That was a red flag for the customs person that I was speaking with, wanted to know who I was meeting and how I knew those people and did I work with those people and, you know, various things. And also what I did, and when I told them that I practiced technology law, I was immediately asked if I help people who hack or compromise security, or I thought that was really, really interesting too. And my following along with the tips of the week on our show and don't be dumb, I of course answered no, because I don't want to think of what would happen if I had answered yes to that question. But I thought it was really interesting that from the U.S. to Canada, you would come under that kind of border scrutiny. Anything to add, Josh, about mandatory social media checks at the border or anything related to this?
It's creepy, and it's a good way to instill fear. It's one thing to go, all right, somebody who is coming from a country that we have heightened concerns about because of terrorist or military activity. It's one thing to do a social media check on that individual. It's another thing to ask for their usernames and passwords. It's another, which I would not think is acceptable under any circumstances. Crossing from Canada into the United States, I actually find that pretty disturbing.
I was going the other way. Okay. U.S. into Canada. It was Canadian customs that was so interested.
Gotcha. I could see that. I worked for a software company, and we had a lot of clients in Canada. So I'd go up there for conferences, and the questions were always like, what hotel is it at, or a conference center, what company, how long are you here? Like, that doesn't bother me. But prying into social media history, there are horror stories about people, coming into the United States who are, being asked for passwords for their phone. And that bothers me, and I look forward to them being future plaintiffs, because that should be a very interesting case, because there are a lot of people who don't like that.
All right, Matt, anything international travel and social media related?
No, I think that the creepiness of it is overwhelming. Obviously, you don't want to be able to check that people are secure coming into the country. This just seems like a little too much.
Right. All right. We were going to do a patent discussion at this juncture of the show, but I think we're going to skip right over that, because that's sort of something we could discuss at any time. There is an interesting patent case before the Supreme Court, and I promise you that we will get to it. But right now, I think we're going to go right into the more fun aspect of our show here, and move away from the bow tie law blog with Josh and more into the Legal Geeks material. And since superheroes fight crime, we're going to talk about this under Crimes and Justice. All right, Josh, we all sort of live vicariously through you and others who get the nod to go to Comic-Con and be on fun panels. There was one that you attended that just looked, this was Comic Fest, I guess I should clarify, that looked amazingly fun. You got to be a lawyer in the trial of the Winter Soldier. Can you tell us about that?
Sure. So San Diego Comic Fest is put together by Mike Towery and his wife, Wendy. And Mike was one of the original 14-year-olds in 1969 that started San Diego Comic-Con. He is a geek legend, and the geek world owes him a debt that can never be repaid, because he's just a wonderful person. So Mike said, we want to do something fun at Fest. Could we do a mock trial? I said, let's do one of the Winter Soldier. So using what we had from Captain America Winter Soldier, we put together the fact pattern for Bucky being tried for treason, insurrection, terrorism, collaboration with the enemy, and a host of other charges. We then had to put together all the supporting documents. So I had to figure out, what would a flying aircraft carrier cost? How much JP-5 jet fuel and munitions and aircraft would get dumped into the Potomac if three of them crashed off Roosevelt Island? And put that all together, and then we did a call for law students to come in and be able to argue this. Then Magistrate Judge Paul Graywall volunteered to preside over this fictional case, because he's a geek, and he's an awesome geek, and I'm very happy for him at Facebook now. but we got these law students. His clerk volunteered to be one of the witnesses, a hostile witness called by the prosecution, and she played Black Widow and did an awesome job. One of her friends was the Winter Soldier. He cosplays at cons, and he had, you know, the arm that he put together. The law students who volunteered, the first one to do so was from my alumni, McGeorge. And Sylvia is her name, and I'm fairly confident she will one day be elected California Attorney General. She's a represents the best of what an attorney can be, an inspirational story. And we got two psychologists to write expert reports on Bucky's mental state, on whether or not he understood the wrongfulness of his actions. And they pulled out all the stops. Each report was about 12 pages long and excellent. They took it so seriously. We then promote this event, and we had 140 people in there. People attended sessions before in order to have good seats for the mock trial. And it was amazing seeing 10-year-olds sitting still, staring intently at an expert witness testifying about somebody's mental state.
People, that's awesome.
It was fantastic. The arguments were great. The students were fantastic when it came to things like doing cross and direct and crossing Widow or crossing Bucky. They rocked at it, and it was so inspirational and so much fun. One of the students, just an amazing story, also in a McGeorge student, and she was going to night school, second in her class, mother of twins, and during her first year of law school was diagnosed with stage 4 breast cancer. Law school is hard enough. Throwing cancer into the mix only makes it harder. And so inspired by her. And we needed help covering like airfare. So like the show was able to help with a couple rooms for the law students, because again, they were starving students. And a need discovery service provider took care of her airfare. And she did a great opening statement. It was so much fun. Somewhere there's a video of it, has yet to make YouTube. It was great seeing the jury deliberate as well. We had jurors. Unbeknownst to me at the time, one guy that we recruited, he's actually the official Jack Kirby biographer. And he was the foreman, and he was neat. So it was good stuff.
Very good. And so cut to the chase. How did Sergeant James Buchanan Bucky Barnes fare in the trial?
It was a hung jury. One person thought he was guilty. The others did not. And the foreman turned to this juror who was holding out, and he asked her, it's like, not to get too personal, but how many times have you been put in and out of cryogenic suspended animation? And it was just like, rock on, dude. But watching them debate it, I mean, they were into it. They paid attention. They took notes. It was really neat to see. But there was one holdout who thought he was guilty. This year, we did an X-Men theme mock hearing. And the premise was, and I wrote this right after the election, not knowing what would happen, but the fictional president of the United States issued an executive order that required the registration of all mutants, and any mutant who refused to comply would be summarily executed by a sentinel because they weren't human beings, therefore the Constitution didn't apply to them. And we had law students argue it. Magistrate Judge Mitch Devin presided over the case. And the students wrote strong motions on each side for bringing the mutant rights group, bringing the TRO, and the law students who were representing the government to oppose this. And again, it was fascinating. We filled a room with a massive civics lesson on how the courts work.
That is so fantastic. I love the way you guys and all your contributors at the Legal Geeks managed to take scenarios from fantasy realms and make them topical and real for people living in our society. And I guess that's why we love things like comic books and superheroes and Star Trek and Star Wars anyway, is because they take our world and just make it more interesting in various ways. I want to get to another item that you have written up at the Legal Geeks shortly. When Jessica was on, we talked about who owned the Millennium Falcon. You have written a post about whether if Han shot first, which we all know he did, if he was legally justified in doing so. So we're going to answer that question for you here in just a moment. But first, we're going to thank our sponsor for this episode of This Week in Law, which is Blue Apron. Blue Apron is the number one fresh ingredient and recipe delivery service in the country. Blue Apron's mission is to make incredible home cooking accessible to everyone, and it delivers seasonal recipes along with fresh, high-quality ingredients. Our family enjoys Blue Apron. We're so excited when we get our deliveries to the house. We get two meals at a time. They're very generously portioned. They're all delicious. I do find, I'm going to give you a little Blue Apron tip here, that they're so generously portioned that we might not get around to making both meals in a week. We can be a little spontaneous around our household and decide spur of the moment, oh, we're going to go out of town and be back in a couple of days. So if that happens, you can oftentimes just take the meat portion, if there's meat involved in your dish, and freeze it. And when you come back, the ingredients come to you so fresh that if they've been sitting in your refrigerator for just a few days, you know, maybe a little less than a week, you should be fine in putting the dish together. If we're just talking about, you know, things like onions and tomatoes and broccoli and stuff, it's probably going to be fine in your fridge to come back and make when it fits your schedule. And they also let it fit your schedule by allowing you to go online and very fine-grained tune up when you want your deliveries to happen, from the day of the week to whether you want it that week at all. They give you really great choices for what you can have delivered. And as I said, their freshness makes it so that even if you can't make it right away, you're going to be fine if you have to let it go for a couple of days before you can cook. They now deliver to 99% of the continental US. There's no weekly commitment, so you only get deliveries when you want them. You can customize your recipes every week based on what you like and what your dietary preferences are. And their recipes are never repeated within a year. You're never gonna get bored. And you can keep those great, really nice, easy to follow recipe cards with great photos of how to do things and what things are supposed to look like step by step as you're making the dish. You can keep those and make that dish again. All the ingredients are right there listed. So, you know, if you loved a dish and you're becoming proficient in making it, you know, don't wait for Blue Apron to send it to you again, because they don't repeat within a year, but you can just put that right in your repertoire and go out and shop for it yourself and make it. Things that you might be putting together are spinach and fresh mozzarella pizza with olives, bell peppers, and ricotta salata, sweet and sour salmon with bok choy, carrot, and ginger fried rice, Parmesan crusted chicken with creamy fettuccine and roasted broccoli, baby broccoli and fontina paninis with hard-boiled egg and arugula salad. Check out this week's menu and get three meals free with your first purchase and free shipping by going to blueapron.com/twill. You'll love how good it feels and tastes to create incredible home-cooked meals with Blue Apron. Thank you so much, Blue Apron, for your support of This Week in Law. Blue Apron, a better way to cook. So, Greedo and Han Solo, Josh. Now, I think that people intuitively would know, number one, that Han shot first, and number two, that he was justified in doing so. But can you explain for us legally how you arrived at that conclusion?
Yes. So, I am very comfortable with the fact that my key contribution as an attorney has been this article on why Han was justified to shoot first. I'm okay with that. Doesn't bother me one bit. So when you break in the, so 2015, a Vulture republished my post before Force Awakens came out, and it was shared there. It had more shares than the Daisy Ridley story that they interview that they had, and it was picked up by 8 or 9 other online publications. So it's like, wow, I feel like I help make an impact on how people can understand law. But you got to break down the key facts, whether it's 1977 or 1997, that Han is in a corner, can't go anywhere. It's not like he can retreat because there's no place to retreat. And there's a weapon pointed directly at him. So when you look at the totality of the facts and the exchange that they had, we have Guido say, you know, Jabba might only take your ship. Han's reply is, over my dead body. And the reply to that is, that's the idea. Mm-hmm. When you're cornered by a bounty hunter and you got no place to go and a weapon's pulled on you, under all of those facts, when you're either applying common law or the model penal code, that looks like it's a justified homicide for using self-defense, because there was no way out of that alive for him. That's the short version of how to explain this.
I absolutely love it. And I love that you also take issue with Greedo having been edited into firing first in the 1997 re-release, where he misses wildly at the extreme close range that he was firing, and that perhaps he was not just a bad shot, but a really bad bounty hunter and should have been a nerf herder.
He should have. There was at Salt Lake Comic Fest a couple years ago, I got to talk with Timothy Zahn, who created Mara Jade and wrote a bunch of great Star Wars books. And a comment that he made while we were talking about this after his panel was, they could have edited in Han, you know, knocking the table up, so at least like hit his hand or something to explain why he missed at point blank range, but they didn't do that, and so it looks tacky. It's why people groan. If you rewind to 1977, we were a different country. Lucas was much younger, didn't have kids, and you know, we were in a rougher era post Watergate. We had, you know, it was the end of the Western period. You know, John Wayne's Shootist came out, I think, in, what, 76? Mm-hmm. I know that was his last movie before he died. And that made sense in the scheme of the Cold War, in having somebody shoot somebody at point-blank range. Now, what we don't see a lot of people talk about are all the times that Malcolm Reynolds shot somebody who was unarmed in Firefly or Serenity. And the key one is in the movie Serenity, when he goes back to Shepard Book's compound hideout,
mm-hmm. Yes.
Everybody's dead and Book is dying, and there's the crashed Alliance warship, and the guy tries surrendering, and Malcolm shoots him dead. That's not okay. Like, that's absolutely not justified. That was just revenge. And, or you juxtapose that to, you know, one of the most powerful scenes in Rogue One, where Cassian, you know, does a really cold-blooded version of Mice and Men with his informant Tuvok, and shoots him before being able to, you know, climb out of there, since Tuvok had a bad arm and couldn't climb. There was absolutely no legal justification for Cassian to shoot him, but there was a real politique, you know, reason that the Alliance would be exposed and bad things could happen, and the Republic could have been crushed. So from, you know, a spy versus spy perspective, it was the right call. It was his only decision, but absolutely not legally justified. I mean, that was murder.
Thank you so much, Josh, for walking us through those from Han to various other war crimes. I think we have our second MCLE passphrase for the show, and that is Greedo the Nerf Herder. It will be... So it shall be. Matt, are you, again, taking notes into how we can incorporate comic book scenarios into the Notre Dame legal clinic curriculum?
First of all, I think that we have our admitted students weekend this weekend, and if Josh was here, we'd have them all signed up. second of all, I think it would have been really interesting if Han Solo would have had a Twitter account and would have posted about it. Then we would have been talking about some both of Josh's expertises.
Absolutely. All right. So we're going to transition here into our resource of the week, tip of the week, and animal selfie of the week. Without further ado, I'm going to point you toward AT&T's privacy policy. This applies to its landline services, its television delivery services, its wireless services. It applies across the board. And the first thing that you'll see when you go there, before you start diving deep into the privacy policy itself and its various permutations, is its promise. If you could show Victor the Twitter picture, what it says is, our privacy commitments are fundamental to the way we do business every day. These apply to everyone who has a relationship with us, including customers, wireless, internet, digital TV and telephone, and website visitors. We will protect your privacy and keep your personal information safe, they are assuring you. We use encryption and other security safeguards to protect customer data. We will not sell your personal information to anyone for any purpose, period. So this is not the policy itself, but these are representations being made by the company. So take note of them. And remember all those things we said earlier in the show about ISPs being held accountable when they, whenever they deceive customers. Know that customers are being assured of what I just told you by AT&T. And then when you dig a little deeper into the policy, there's no real gotcha here. I just want you to know that there is more detail to the policy than their assurances given there. The part you should go to, and we've put these in the discussion points so you can go and look at it yourself if you're an AT&T customer, is the questions about information sharing. So they tell you how they share your information. Do that you share my personal information internally? Yes, and they tell you how. Do you share my personal information with other non-AT&T companies for them to market to me? The question of the week, right, in light of what we've seen happen with the congressional review of the FCC rules. AT&T says, we will only share your personal information with other non-AT&T companies for them to use for the marketing of their own products and services when we have your consent. So that's how we get to the opt-out provision. Unfortunately, the way this works is they have your consent unless you opt out. And so there are various other provisions here where they're asking about various data. Do you share it with others? They have various information about how they'll reveal your data in response to a court order. But this when we have your consent issue comes up a couple of times. So if you are someone who's not inclined to give AT&T your consent to them advertising to you or sharing your data with others, you're going to want to go to their rights and choices section of the privacy policy. And there you can opt out of relevant advertising delivered by AT&T. And there's a whole manage your privacy choices section. You have to have an AT&T account to go in and manage those privacy choices. But it, you know, this is what the market is left with. As far as this ISP goes, this is how they manage things. So you need to have an account, you need to go in and you need to acquaint yourself with your privacy choices and exercise those choices in a way that makes sense for you. So there is AT&T, and we're gonna try and go through as many ISPs as we can, and we'd love to hear from you about what ISPs you want to see highlighted in this segment of the show. There are many of them out there. Aside from all the biggies, I'd love to hear from you if you use an ISP that you think has a really good approach toward privacy and you feel good about using them for that reason. In fact, maybe you selected them for that reason. Would love to highlight some of those companies. So please do keep the suggestions, discussions coming. I'm Denise at TWiT TV. We'd love to examine the privacy policies that you are most interested in and hopefully give you some options for other companies to consider so that you can vote with your feet and your dollars and tell companies what you like about how they manage your privacy and what you don't. Our tip of the week is how to clickbait a brief. This was highlighted by Michael Barkley, who we've had on the show. He found a brief filed by parties named, I'm not going to try and pronounce that, Webzilla and others, against BuzzFeed by lawyers Evan Frey-Witzer, Valentin Gervitz, and Brady J. Cobb. This was filed in Florida. It's a jurisdiction issue that's at stake here, and it's a response to a motion to dismiss. The title of the brief, instead of opposition to motion to dismiss or other dry such title, is 6 Ways BuzzFeed Has Misled the Court, Number 2 Will Amaze You, and a Picture of a Kitten. And they go on to say, in a somewhat remarkable motion to dismiss, plaintiffs BuzzFeed and Ben Smith intimate that their ties to Florida are so sparse that collectively they can barely find Florida on a map, and that as a result, the present case should be dismissed for lack of jurisdiction or transferred to the Southern District of New York. Two of the lawyers who filed this were Boston lawyers, and one is a Florida local lawyer. And I particularly like to the use of a kitten, which is footnoted in the title here. The picture of the kitten can be found at Exhibit 41 to the Schaefer Declaration. So what an effective way to highlight and make sure the court actually gets around to looking at Exhibit 41, because there they will find the treasure of a picture of a kitten. So this was just delightful, and I think a sign of the times that everything is becoming clickbait in our world. And with that, nothing is much more clickbaity than a good animal selfie, and we're gonna leave you with one of those. So here we have a fellow who was on a trip to Bali and decided to feed the monkeys. I think he was visiting a temple or on his way to a temple and decided to feed the monkeys some fruit. And here's what happened. A little fruit for the monkeys. Oh, the monkeys will come in from that direction, eh? That's what one would think. Except for the one that takes the camera. And runs off with the camera. Get some nice footage where the monkey is the director. We do get a selfie of the monkey at some point. It's a little dark. Monkey needs some help with the lighting. Ooh, that looked like a human hand. I don't know how this all went down exactly. But there's the monkey. Monkey selfie. Not the most famous monkey selfie you've ever seen, but a legitimate monkey photographer monkey selfie. For your viewing pleasure. All right. Thanks so much for joining us. With that, we're going to go ahead and wrap up the show. Bob Cattanach had to leave early, but we were so grateful to him and the Dorsey firm and Mike Keyes for referring him to us for this episode of TWiL. Josh Gilliland, it's been really wonderful meeting you. Thanks so much for joining us today.
Pleasure to be here. Thank you.
Hope to have you back. Anything going on in your practice or any wonderful comic slash fantasy world oriented conventions you're going to be attending anytime soon?
So California's Associate Supreme Court Justice Cuellar recommended that I speak at the Appellate Judicial Attorneys Institute next week, which will have about 200 attorneys who work for the California Court of Appeals and the California Supreme Court on Star Wars. So
I look forward
to speaking to the powers that be in California on legal issues in Star Wars. And we are going to be submitting for San Diego Comic-Con this first week or so of April. So we will know if we get in towards the end of May. And we have four solid proposals. So I hope they accept one.
Oh, good. Can you publicly discuss them or are they hush hush?
I'll say what we're going to do, propose. One is judges on Star Wars. I won't name the judges who are interested in being on this panel, but they'll be talking about what Star Wars means to them and different legal issues, clone rights, droid rights, that sort of thing. One will be Jack Kirby on civil rights, since it's the centennial of Jack Kirby. So that proposal focuses on all the civil rights issues and justice issues that are in Kirby characters, from Captain America to Fantastic Four to the X-Men. One other one is a mock trial to prove the actual innocence of Luke Cage. And that one, it's a solid proposal and excited about that. Mm-hmm. And then there's one on law and psychology. And so we have a psychologist. And that would discuss, you know, how would you prove someone who'd been Kilgraved with the insanity defense? How would you defend them? Who is the legal guardian of Baby Groot? So we will and that will be a future post because that needs to be resolved before the movie comes out. So
yes,
we'll see again if they take one. I'd be super happy. But we'll do four pitches, and hopefully one will be accepted.
I'm sure folks have seen the Guardians of the Galaxy trailer and know that Baby Groot is responsible for blowing some stuff up. So we need to know.
There's child endangerment, like who's financially responsible for that. I mean, there's all kinds of great stuff. All kinds of great stuff.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much, Josh. I will say I already have my tickets to see Guardians of the Galaxy 2 on May 4th. Hey, can't wait.
God bless you.
Hopefully we'll see you there.
Yes.
Hey, Matt, how about you? Are you going to be there on May 4th or maybe wait till it hits on demand?
I think I've got exams that day. Maybe I'll skip them, though.
But primary reason to finish law school so that you can design your movie schedule more effectively.
Yes. The bright future's a bit far away now.
That's good. It's been really fun to have you on the show. Tell us more about what you're going to do with A Pint of Law.
So we are looking into patent litigation, and so the courts incentivize patent litigation. They believe that it increases competition. I'm looking with my professor Yelderman. He's a patent and copyright professor, and so we're going to look at what industries it does increase competition and where it doesn't, trying to reformulate the rules for that. So that one I'm really excited about. And then we've got some data security in relation to funding ISIS. So we've got a full bench next week. We had some cancellations this week, so we'll have two or three next week.
Great, and I'm blanking on your tagline, but it's wonderful. It's something about explaining law in a way that law presented in a way you could explain to your bartender. Am I close?
Yeah. So I'm still working on it. I think that's a good one, but I think that we'll try to have some revolving taglines. I think that the bar and pints they go well for law jokes. So
they do.
We'll try to be creative with that one.
All right. Good. Well, thank you so much for joining us this week, and thank you so much for your help with the show. We haven't yet lined up an email address, a TWiT email address that's in progress for Matt, but we'll let you know when that's in place. He's going to be helping with bookings and many, many other things. So we'll let you know how to get in touch with him directly once we've got that in place. But in the meantime, you can email me. I'm Denise at twit.tv. Find me on Twitter. I'm at D Howell there. The show has both Facebook and Google Plus pages. Good places to let us know what you would like us to talk about, guests you would like to see invited on the show, your feedback on things we've discussed, all great forums for that. ISPs, you would like us to look at their privacy policies. So definitely keep your suggestions and ideas coming. We love them. Can't do the show without our wonderful, wonderful listeners and followers and viewers. So we really, really appreciate your participation in the show and your help in knowing what direction we should go. So thanks for joining us this week. If you've done so at 11 o'clock Pacific time, 1800 UTC, you have joined us when we record the show live. Congratulations, warts and all, you get us. We don't edit the show much, but we do put out a lightly edited post-production version of the show that goes up on our website at twit.tv/twill. In fact, our entire archive of shows is there. So if you want to go back in time travel with This Week in Law, please feel free. We love it when you do. We love making the show available in formats that make it easy for you to enjoy on your own time and on your device of choice. So everything you need to know about doing that is right there at our twit.tv/twill site. Mike Keyes will be back next week here on This Week in Law. If you're missing Mike, until then, we will see you soon. We hope you take care.